in the 17th, 18th century, there were people who said, let's apply standards of scientific rationality to a much wider range of subjects. Let's do history on scientific principles. Let's think about society and political organization on scientific principles. Let's try and understand human nature in that way. And so this was trying to think in an orderly and disciplined way about things. And it had tremendous consequences. I mean, you think of the outcome of the Enlightenment in the great changes politically and socially that followed it. The advent, for example, of democracy and of human rights and civil liberties and the much wider spread of education and the refutation of the claims of absolute monarchy and of religion. So these were good things. And there were, of course, people much later, people like Horkheimer and Adorno and others in the Frankfurt School who said, the Enlightenment was to blame for Nazism and Stalinism because it privileged kind of organized bureaucracy and bureaucracy goes rotten after a time, blah, blah. They're wrong about that. But anyway, that's a different story. But the people who objected to Enlightenment rationality were the Romantics, who said, if you have reason dominating life, then it desiccates life. It just takes all the color and all the magic and music out of it. And we romantics think that it should all be about how we feel, and it should be about our connection with the soil or the land or the people or the folk or the this, that, and the other.
Yeah.
Now, I like to point out that we would not for one minute like to dispense with the poetry and the music of Romanticism, but we could certainly do without the politics and sociology and anthropology of Romanticism, because that's where nationalism and Nazism and racism and all that stuff come from. Mm-hmm. I mean, talking about, you know, our adherence to the land or to the blood or to our ancestors or, you know, the race or something, you know, all that is pernicious, and we've seen the effect of that. So the anti-rationalist reaction to the Enlightenment produced all these evils, which really, you know, caused so many deaths. And think of the first, especially the Second World War. And it illustrates, gives you this marvelous historical illustration of how, if you are just irrationally anti-rational, and you're going to privilege all sorts of other things that dominate the way you act and think about the world, you're going to get into trouble. Because the rationalism of the Enlightenment itself never, ever claimed that reason should operate at the expense of emotion,
yes,
or at the expense of those things in life that give it its sense of value and sentiment. In fact, it's so interesting to notice that in the Enlightenment itself, the idea of sentiment, the idea of the importance of romance in life, the idea that our emotions are important motivators for our choices in life. David Hume, one of the great figures in
reason
the Enlightenment.
Reason is a slave of passion.
Exactly. You know, then in other words, the result was that the Enlightenment drive to think more rationally, not at the expense of our emotions, but just more rationally, was read by those who were frightened of what reason might expose about the inadequacies of absolute monarchy and religious tyranny, you know, to do this black and white thing, all reason is bad.